Stand up.
All right, there she is now. Very excited to get her on the podcast. I've been trying to get her on the podcast for a long time. I've been reading her work, talked to her before, but she's one of my favorite writers and reporters. She's now freelancing, and I just saw you tweeting 5 years that you've been freelancing, Bryce. Congratulations. Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you, and thanks for having me on. I'm glad it worked out.
When you think about just like a question as to why somebody might want to do the type of work that you, when they go into your world, if they want to do journalism, if they want to write about the types of things that you want to write about, you've worked at all kinds of different places. Why are you doing freelance? If you had some offer, some big corporate media, would you be considering it? Or is it like a lifestyle choice? Can you do better work?
I think you can do good work in both places. I am really proud of the work I did. Before I was freelance, I was on staff at ThinkProgress, which no longer exists. So I'm really proud of what we did there. I think a lot of it is personality type. I really like to be self-directed. I really like to push myself harder, but also be able to be the one who sets my own limits when I want to take some time away. It works really well for me. I know it doesn't work well for everybody. Some people want more structure. Some people want more guidance. I've always been someone who just wants to be let loose to go do it by myself. I was never good at team projects at school.
Right. And I love your work at ThinkProgress. That's where I discovered your work. And like, I didn't know you have a genderless name or something. So it's like probably a couple of years. I think I probably thought you were a guy. None of it matters. But it was just like I read this name so much. And then I finally was like, who is this person? And then learn a little bit more about you. But is it that in certain other outfits, organizations, they'll assign a project to you and you would rather be like looking at the trends, looking at the issues, looking at what's happened right now in the news. For example, you're writing about baby bonds. Like, I want to write about that.
Right. Yeah, I think that happened a fair bit. And it's understandable. In a newsroom, they've got a mandate, they've got funding they have to think about. And so, I would get assigned something, and it's harder to say no when you're on staff. I can say no whenever I want now. And I also have found ways to pursue stories that are a little bit harder to get through on the news, like baby bonds. I mean, it's one state. So Connecticut has just become the first state to enact baby bonds for all low-income kids. And I think it's really exciting, but it's incremental state-level change. It's not something that necessarily a big newsroom is going to jump on. So I have the freedom to do that, as well as, you know, longer term projects that take more time.
I want to talk about that article and that issue. I just heard those two words back to back for like 2 weeks ago. And I guess it must have been in relation to this passing in Connecticut. And it sounds like an amazing idea. And I want to try to be like a crazy right winger and argue against it. So let's get ready. But I do have to call you on a tweet from yesterday really quick. It was really bothering me because I feel like you've always been honest and I just like I don't know if this is exaggeration, but you tweeted at Bryce Covert some very New York City things I saw in my run today. A woman on a bike with a clear backpack full of parakeets.
Yeah. Okay.
Do you have time to just unpack these three?
Yes.
Because
yes,
it was really one of my favorite tweets, but it also, I just don't believe that there was a person with a clear backpack filled with birds.
Full is not the right word, but she was definitely on a bike, and she had, have you seen those backpacks that have like a clear globe for a pet? It was that, but it wasn't like a cat or a bunny, which I've seen. It was parakeets. I think there was maybe like two or three of them. It was a little fast. It was hard to know, but one was blue, one was green.
No.
And she just went whizzing by. And I was like, those are parakeets in that woman's.
How long do you spend on that in your brain before your brain, you're out for a run. So I don't know.
I'm out for a run. So I'm like not thinking about anything really. And I think it was like sort of like backpack, you know, didn't notice clear backpack. Oh, interesting. Oh, there's something in it. It's small and it's a bird. And there's multiple birds.
So my thought is, this woman has birds and she likes to take them out.
Yeah. My thought is that she thinks she's doing them the favor of like getting them into their natural habitat, which
she isn't, is she?
What I worry about anytime I see any animal outside that's not a dog on a leash, I just really worry it's going to escape. Cats are very wily. Yep. Rabbits are very small and slippery. And parakeets fly. It's just, I just worry for them that their poor little pets are going to.
I'm, you don't know me, but I'm judgmental. It's like my, I'm not proud of it. As a comedian, you kind of almost have to become that in a sad way. But I think that she's a monster. I think that's tort. I think keeping birds as pets is kind of unethical, unless it's an injured bird that you're saving or something, you know. But like to go buy a bird and then you put it in a cage, it's, you're taking flight from them. And then she's bringing it out there and she's bringing them. So like, imagine being able to fly.
Yeah.
And you see the sky. Okay. I mean, the other,
those
ahead.
Birds don't even know what they're seeing, probably, to be fair to those birds.
I disagree. All they know is the sky.
Those birds were raised in captivity. Those birds have never seen a tree branch in their life, I would imagine.
At least not one in New York City. They're clearly not indigenous to Brooklyn or wherever. Man also saw a man walking around holding a full piece of naan bread.
It was like this big. Yep, it was round.
See, this made me laugh and it made me really like your sense of humor. I started laughing because what's notable is that it was a full.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
if it had been like, you know, a little like triangle of it and he was, you know, munching on it, I'd have been like, all right, you're eating some naan as you walk down the street. But he wasn't eating it. He was holding it and it was large. Because I looked at it and I was like, what is that man holding? Is it like a bag? Is it some papers? And I got closer and it was a naan.
You got closer. Did you get closer on purpose? Did you go out of your way?
No, no.
We
passed each other and I wasn't trying to get his naan. That was his naan.
Oh God, you should have snatched it and gave it to parakeet lady. Okay. And finally, a Hasidic Jewish man on a scooter.
Yeah.
With a plastic bag over his, how do you pronounce it? Hoysha hat?
You know what? I don't know how to pronounce it. I just wanted to be specific because it's not like he was wearing a baseball cap. He was wearing a formal Hasidic cap, but it was underneath a plastic, you know, shopping bag.
Full, like long pants, long. This is the thing. My wife has a client, several clients she works with that are Orthodox, and she's been like starting to argue with them about how warm they dress.
Aww.
She's like, I understand you have to cut your skin, but why wool?
Yeah.
Why not cotton? Is there anything against?
And black wool.
Oh,
I mean,
God.
he was in a full black wool suit, and it was
hot, very
humid yesterday. There was this image. We were both going downhill and he started taking off and it was kind of misty because it was between rainstorms. And I wish I had been able to stop and take a picture because there's this man on a scooter with a bag on his head, just off into the misty distance. It was really nice.
New York City. So, I mean, that is a hilarious tweet and reason why everybody should follow Bryce on Twitter right now. Okay. There's a lot more, but you know.
I swear I don't tweet about running very often, but sometimes
you should.
You got to.
Listen, I'm up. If it's that animated every time, I'm up for a tweet covering every one of your runs. I miss running in New York City. All right. And speaking of New York City, and I did see you tweeting about it. Let's just real quick. I didn't realize this. I think I saw this on your Twitter. I've been really preparing a lot to talk to you. Everybody across, like everybody saw that tweet from the storms that took place yesterday, crazy weather in New York.
Yeah.
And they saw this video went viral of this woman wading through the staircase, like at the subway. And I think you tweeted just a reminder, or you retweeted at least maybe, the governor, the New York State is responsible for the subways and not New York City necessarily, which is kind of confusing and upsetting. But more importantly, the city knows it needs to prepare since Hurricane, what was it?
Sandy.
For these inevitable weather, flooding, mostly water, and they can't. So I just thought that was really important. What else can you tell us about New York City's lack of preparation or the budget issue?
Oh, God. I mean, we've had so many
cities nationwide too.
This is not unique to New York, but we certainly have had some really big issues in New York. There was a couple summers ago, New Yorkers will remember what I'm talking about. Trains were just breaking down all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Like I had a very good friend who was stuck underground for, I think it was an hour or two. And it was one of those, like, am I going to just be stuck here forever moments? I would worry about my husband getting home from his commute every day because trains were getting stuck underground because our trains were so old and our tracks are so old. The system needs to be upgraded. There's just so much that needs to be done. It obviously takes dollars. I mean, one point of empathy with the state is that, you know, states have limited budgets. We obviously, if you've been paying attention to the news, we don't spend enough on infrastructure in this country, and public transit is one of the biggest victims of that. And so, you know, Andrew Cuomo, New York's governor, has not devoted the resources to actually upkeep and maintain our subway for some time. But it would be a lot easier for him to do that and all states to do that if we had better federal funding, which is the big debate in Washington, D.C. right now. So we'll see if anything comes from that. But yeah.
Help me understand. You had a great piece about the New York Times about this. The debate titled "The Debate Over What Infrastructure is ridiculous." I love the headline.
All credit to my editor.
You've been arguing and covering these issues, all things economics, for years. And when it comes to infrastructure, there is this kind of ideological departure now down political lines about its need, what it is, and most importantly, funding it. But it was traditionally something that Republicans and Democrats at the state and national level were able to agree on, that yes, the government's role, one of the government's role, is to fund infrastructure, and that can be paid for using the gas tax and other taxes, of course. But now it's seemingly that Republicans, yeah, they're all for it, but they're not for paying for it, and it never gets seemingly done. And right. You can look at all kinds of different assessments of our infrastructure, but mostly it's embarrassing. So where do you think, in terms of like the political arguments and ideology, are on this? I mean, how come they couldn't get it done during Trump even?
Yeah.
It became a joke.
Yeah. Every week was infrastructure week under Trump. I mean, I think that Trump was just not serious about all sorts of things, including infrastructure. He didn't want to govern. And
Republicans in Congress? Like, what leave them out?
Them don't want to govern either, I think I would say. I do think you're right that on its face, this should be a sort of an easy bipartisan thing. And then you get into the details and it starts to break down, even on basic things like roads, bridges, tunnels, public transit. The argument over, do you spend it on roads? Do you spend it on trains? Try to upgrade our system so that we're not so reliant on cars, becomes political. And then the how do you pay for it is just always the issue, right? And now it's, you know, Republicans say we want to make the users pay for it, as if somehow corporations aren't the users of our infrastructure that gets their goods across the country and their workers to their offices.
Let me just ask you a larger question, because you've been covering this forever. And this comes up with a lot of people I talk to on a regular basis a lot. And it's like, Grover Norquist has done more damage to this country than almost any other single person, because he's just made Republicans swear a blood oath at every level of government to never raise taxes. And so it's a question when it comes to infrastructure, because you make a very convincing argument about what infrastructure really is, but we can't even invest in hard traditional infrastructure because they refuse to raise taxes. And instead, we're looking at tax rates that are lowest they've ever been. Wealth inequities are the highest they've ever been. So just your thoughts on the history of the conservative movement and the anti-tax and tax cutting movement, and what that's actually done to communities in the country in terms of not being able to do shit.
Yeah, very small topic to address.
I know, but I still want to get your take on it, however you want to take it.
You're absolutely right. I mean, we are an extremely low tax country. Republicans like to say otherwise, but we are. Our tax rates are very low, both at the top income level and for the corporate level. And it's historically low. We haven't always done it this way. We have, in the past, increased taxes on those who can afford to pay it. Corporations and the wealthy have paid much more in taxes. We had the money to therefore invest in our country, and we saw economic growth and prosperity from doing that. And basically, since the 70s and 80s, we've decided not to do it that way, to lower and lower and lower tax rates. That's basically been the trend, with some bumps here and there, to slightly increase them back to where they'd been a year or two ago, and then we keep declining. It leaves us less room to invest, and also, perhaps maybe even more importantly, it leads to extreme income and wealth inequality. It allows people to amass massive fortunes that then just get passed generation to generation without being taxed, and we are reaping what we have sown.
Yes, we are. Great way to wrap that huge point out. Yes, we're absolutely, the chickens are coming home to roost.
Yes.
I mean, it's nuts. In your New York Times piece, you make this, you know, really great points, using all kinds of data points to make them. And just so the larger point is, if we can't repair our roads and bridges and our pipes and everything else, if you can't go to work because you have a kid, that needs to be taken care of. And oh, by the way, the schools are closed, or because you have an elderly parent that you need to take care of, or because you have an injury or illness or any number of real life things that happen all the time. So we have to invest in helping families and individuals with kids or people that have developmental disabilities, injuries, or just the elderly. And more importantly, I feel like, and you didn't do this in this piece, but I know you have in the past, we know this works. This works in so many other countries. And you do talk about where it is happening, and it can also take us to Connecticut in a minute. But talk to me about the is it soft infrastructure? What do we call it? The actual investing in people and preschool, et cetera.
I think people are calling it the sort of the care infrastructure, the care economy. I honestly was kind of shocked that that was controversial, that the idea that child care and elder care and care for disabled people is infrastructure, that got so much debate. It just seems extremely obvious to me. So I wrote that piece to try to sort of explain why. But I mean, like you said, if you've got if you're at home and your kid can't go to daycare because it was shut down for some reason, or your home health aide is late because you need them to come care for an elderly parent, you can't get to work. You can't do your job. These are just sort of basic facts. And like you said, perhaps I didn't get into it as much, but we know in other countries, as well as some places within our own country, that when you invest in these things, people are able to get to work. It's not that we're forcing anyone to work. If someone would rather stay in home to care for their kid themselves, if they want to do the elder care themselves because that's important to them, you absolutely can. But when you need it and when you want it, in other places it's available, and that does allow people to choose their careers, to follow the kind of work they want to do, pick the jobs they want to do, and actually show up and perform them. I mean, I think there's also something to be said for the mental space it gives you to do well at your job when you know that your child is getting a good education, and when you know that your aging mother is getting good care. That really matters.
Yeah, those are hard things to measure, I guess, in economics. And if you don't care about people's, mood and emotions while they work. I mean, like, even if you're just an uncaring boss or capitalist and you still want the most output, then you would want someone to not be distracted while they're running the backhoe.
Yeah, and you've seen the Chamber of Commerce, for example, come out really strongly saying we need investment in childcare, particularly in the pandemic. They have been lobbying Congress to do something about this because their employees can't get to work when there's no daycares, when there's no in-person school. It's become everybody's problem. And it was always everybody's problem. It's just that we told families that they had to deal with it by themselves individually in a private market. And I think it's become very clear that that does not work, and that there is such a need for the public to play a role here.
You also introduced me to something I'd never, ever heard of this until I read your piece in the New York Times. But you write, the idea that childcare that allows parents and in particular mothers to work is critical infrastructure is not even a new concept in our country. In 1940, the government passed the Lanham Act. Folks, look it up. Never heard of it until I read Bryce's piece in the New York Times. To fund the construction and maintenance of the infrastructure deemed critical to the country as it fought World War II. Because it became clear there were not enough childless women. So they were putting all the women to work, but there weren't enough childless women to work in all the factories we'd built while men were fighting abroad. Newspapers ran stories about children chained in trailer homes and locked in their cars because their mothers had no other options when they went to work. The government needed bodies in factories to make guns and planes to fight the war. So these funds were used to build and maintain physical child care centers, pay and train the teachers inside them, and cover operating expenses for a new national network of affordable quality child care centers that were open to all, not just Rosies in the factories. And there's links in here. That was fascinating. And you look back in time at that era, and it's like, now that's called what? Socialism, Marxism, and communism. I'm hearing them all using them together today. But I mean, it worked. It worked. Yep. Right?
It worked. It worked at the time, and it also had lasting dividends for both the children and the women who were able to participate. The children, the quality was so high that the children went on later to earn more, to graduate college more frequently. The women were attached to the labor force, so they didn't really stop working even after the war effort. It continued to increase their earnings and their work hours. But yeah, it absolutely worked. I mean, the government sort of looked around and said, oh crap, we need people in our factories building our planes and our guns, and we've run out of childless women, and now they're dumping them in like movie theaters, and this is not good for anybody. We should do something about it.
And you see that kind of thing today. I mean, you're talking about, you know, chaining them to this or that, so the kid doesn't get into trouble. I mean, I almost understand that when my daughter was really little, when my older one was little, my wife would be working out in the living room, personal training in Manhattan, and I would be like out late doing stand up, I'd be exhausted, and my daughter, like, I don't know, she's 8 months old, and I just couldn't stay awake, so I'd like put my fingers like in the back of her diaper, so if she like got away, I'd be like, what, where are you going? But it was like, so you had to stay. I was so tired. I'm trying to think of something from my life. But the point is, you hear all these stories, woman's working minimum wage at McDonald's and leaves her kid at the park for an hour or something. She gets arrested.
Yep.
I mean, she's trying to work. So we're talking about government providing funding for these people, especially these women, and you mentioned the home healthcare aides that know that they're going to work so that the people that they're working for can go to work too. I love that point. Yeah.
Right.
Baby bonds. Great idea. Connecticut, although we'll hear the right say, why should I work hard? My hard-earned tax money is going to pay for these poor people's bonds as an investment for their child's college education. But...
Well, it's a way to address what we were talking about before, which is the wealth inequality that we've just allowed to grow and grow and grow in this country. You know, it's very easy to pass on wealth when you already have it, and it gives the next generation a leg up. The idea behind this is to give low-income families, that generation, a leg up as well. It's not a ton of money. You know, by the time these kids turn 18, it's something like $10,000. So it's not like they're getting a free ride anywhere. But it's supposed to hopefully allow them to choose what they want to do. You know, it's meant for college. You could use it to try to buy a home. You could use it to start a business. Again, it's a very little bit of seed money, but it could help you sort of get over the hurdle for it. And also, as they're growing up, the hope is that they will think of themselves differently, that this is an option that's actually potentially feasible for them. You know, I think parents always want the best for their kids and do everything they can to give them every opportunity. But when you're working minimum wage, it's hard to instill in your kid this idea that they should do whatever they want and be whatever they be if you don't have the money to help them get to college or don't have the money to help them start a business if that's what they want. So this is supposed to help alleviate that as well. You know, I think they are really interesting. I think they could have a huge impact on not just wealth inequality, but racial wealth gaps. Given the makeup of the kids that this will be targeting, they're disproportionately kids of color. It's the white families in Connecticut that can pass on their wealth over and over and let it accrue. So this helps give them a better leg up. The challenge is that it doesn't hit until they're 18, right? So you're still not addressing what families need as these kids are growing up when finances are always, always tight. I mean, we were just talking about the cost of childcare being absolutely outrageous. So I think you always need to pair something like this with immediate investments in what families need to keep their kids healthy and safe. But it's part of an overall package to level the playing field a bit.
Been talking a lot about patriotism this week because of the 4th of July. And as you're talking there, and I'm thinking about like the conservative arguments, I'm always thinking about the conservative arguments. And it's like, what could be more patriotic than, seriously, I mean, try to spin this for me, but what could be more patriotic than universal pre-K, baby bond, the government investing in the youth of America to give that youth an opportunity to get the best possible education to then contribute back to America? It's like the most patriotic idea in the world. And I was also thinking about how I had a bunch of bonds given to me by like my uncle. And it's like a pretty well-known traditional, it's a thoughtful gift. Like when my daughters were born, a friend of ours gave us a bond. And it's like, oh, that's really nice that someone did that for me, but that's not a policy driven. That's, in this case, government is saying, here's a great responsible idea. We invest now, the family can't touch it or take it away. The kid gets it when it's 18, it's earmarked for education. Boom, it's a minimal investment for a maximum return is the way I see that. Super conservative, if you want.
I think it is. I think it's really hard to argue. You know, Republicans are all about self-reliance and you should have financial literacy and be smart with your money and invest it well. You can't do those things if you don't have the money in the first place. So this is a way to give a little bit more of that to everybody so that they can make those smart decisions that you know, we're asking them to make later on, to go to school, to buy a house. You know, this is, I think, a very conservative friendly policy, whether or not they get on board.
So, well, you know, a lot of people talk about throughout the Trump era, and I would argue this has been the case for a long time. And who wrote the book? Cruelty is the point. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of horrible policies. A lot of them have to do with, you know, we can go on and on, the drug war, incarceration, and so on. But like Medicaid work requirements were brutal. They're just so cruel, so mean. And you've written about this recently. I think this was at The Nation, about how it looks like that's over. It looks like we're not going to have to be concerned with Medicaid work requirements. The headline at The Nation is Medicaid work requirements appear to be dead. What are they, and can you help me explain why they were so cruel and ineffective?
Yeah. So just overall, the Trump administration was all about work requirements, which is this idea that if you're going to get a public benefit, you must be required to put in a certain amount of work, or in some cases you could volunteer maybe or go to school instead. They wanted to do it in basically everything. They made arguments in any program they could, but they were able to stand them up briefly in Medicaid. Medicaid is the health insurance program for low-income people in the country, and they wanted to say, well, if you're going to get health insurance benefits, you have to put in this work. And it's, to be clear, one of the pernicious things about work requirements is not just the requirement to work, even though most people on these programs already work,
yeah,
although it varies a lot, so often it's a stopgap until they get to the next job. But it's really the paperwork burden, because you're having to go somewhere and prove it month after month, you know, make your way through what is always a complicated design. And in truth, what it's really meant to do is to whittle the rolls and to kick people off when they are unable to prove it and get through that maze of red tape. And that's what we saw. One state, Arkansas, actually stood up a work requirement in their Medicaid program. It was the first time ever in the history of the country. And they lost 18,000 people off their rolls within a couple of months. It is very hard to see how it is designed to do anything but that, in all sorts of ways. Just the paperwork required, the lack of information, the way these people's lives work and their jobs work, they were set up to fail, and many of them did.
I always think about when I lost the corporate gig at Sirius and desperately wanted to not go back to corporate media and wanted to try to make this thing work on my own. You know, we had to find out how to get insurance, which was a fucking nightmare. And luckily for Obamacare and the Medicaid expansion, and as soon as I lose my insurance, we have our first healthcare issue. My daughter's diagnosed with scoliosis, and it's not like serious, but needs treatment, potential surgery, and definitely in a very expensive brace, which would have been covered. And my wife handles this whole thing. And I remember her tough as nails, like toughest person I know, but I remember her getting like emotional. And she said, as she's trying to navigate the health insurance requirements and how to get the best policy for our family, she gets all emotional and says, I have a master's degree. If someone didn't speak good English, they'd be completely fucked. And that, I keep thinking about that as I'm reading that article. If you're working at, you know, doing some manual labor outside, some horrible job, you're an immigrant, you don't speak English, and your Medicaid's running out, you're trying to navigate this, forget about it. It's so impossible, and it seems to be made that way, especially for people who have language barriers, is what I'm trying to keep coming back to on these types of issues. People who need it most, they make it hardest for them to even apply for it.
Yeah, I mean, even just someone like you or I, who is a native English speaker, college educated, white collar job, think about how much you know about your healthcare package if it's employer sponsored, and how you would go about figuring that out on your own if it wasn't set up by an employer. And then every single month having to go through it again, documenting how much you work and making your way through a complicated government website that is not user friendly. Also, their website shut down overnight for some reason every night, so you could only do it during certain hours.
No, they did not close their website during certain hours when the people were working the night shift.
Yeah, it was bizarre.
Websites closed. We'll return at 4.
Yep.
Like, that's crazy. I can't even imagine a reason why anybody would close a website for anything ever.
I mean, the whole experiment really just proved that the point is not to help people work. The point is to penalize poor people and to kick them off of these programs. That was the point. And it made it extremely difficult all the way through. If what you want to do is to connect people with work, then you give them a support like Medicaid so that their health concerns are taken care of, their bodies are healthy, their minds are healthy, and they're able to go and do their work. You take that away. I talked to one man in Arkansas who had asthma as well as a hernia, and he said, I want to work. And every time I do, I end up in the hospital. So what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to, you know, if I don't work, I lose my Medicaid, I lose my access to my inhaler, I lose access to the surgery I'm supposed to have, but I have to, you know, I have to work in order to keep this health insurance. Where does that leave me? And countless other people are in the exact same kind of
situation. Well, I don't know who this guy is, but he sounds lazy to me. He sounds lazola.
And the day I met him, he'd walked on foot, talking about how to know how to do this. He'd walked on foot to a food bank, hoping they could help him figure out how to keep his Medicaid. And they couldn't. They said, that's not what we do. And then he walked away because he didn't have a car, into the cold to try to go figure it out somewhere else. And I don't know what happened to him. I hope that he was able to keep his Medicaid, and I hope he was able to get healthy, but no one was making it easy for him.
I make the joke because you have a great piece, and this will be the last one. I know I'm probably even over time already, Bryce, but I love talking to you. It's titled, There is No Crisis of Laziness. Republicans seem determined to make workers so financially desperate that they'll labor for whatever pay employers deign to offer. There's been a really interesting debate and discussion as a result of the pandemic and the unemployment that was given. And anybody, and I really want to get your take on this, can point to several anecdotes of people who said out loud, why would I go back to work when I'm getting paid by the government? Why would I go back? I'm sure there's plenty of people who said that, but it's not even remotely close to most people. Right, it's not the case. Most people, as you make the point here, want to work, want to get paid and everything that comes with it, want to get away from their kids that they've been on top of for the last year and so on. But that's not how the discussion happens in media, much less in politics. The discussion is always about that person, those anecdotes. But we do have data. You always refer to the data. There is no crisis of laziness. Make the case.
People have been looking at this question over and over again. They looked at it during the Great Recession. They've been looking at it now during the pandemic to see if you give people enhanced benefits, unemployment benefits, longer time to stay on, bigger checks, cover more people, does it mean that fewer people want to work? And the answer is just always no. It doesn't lead them to look for work at lower rates. It doesn't have an impact on employment. You know, there were times during the pandemic where these benefits have lapsed because of Congress. There was no sudden rush to jobs. There was no huge spike in employment because there's other factors at play. I mean, first of all, like you said, I really think that Americans are smart and have, on the whole, really good work ethics. They know that unemployment is temporary, and they know that a job is hopefully much more solid than that. It's ongoing income versus a temporary benefit. People are smart enough to understand that equation and choose a job when it makes sense. The challenge, I think, right now is, first of all, we are coming out of a historic shake of our entire system. I mean, we just haven't ever lived through anything like this. It's going to be a bumpy road. There are going to be some mismatches. I also think that employees are looking at their jobs and questioning whether they were getting paid well enough and being treated well enough to go back to them, particularly in service sector jobs that paid crap, didn't treat them well, often didn't come with benefits. We've all been through a life or death situation, particularly in these roles. I mean, line cook was the occupation with the highest death toll rate from COVID. Yeah. You know, understand line cook. You're stuck in a kitchen with your colleagues in unventilated, often unair-conditioned spaces. I understand why people are questioning what it takes to go back to work. Not that they don't want to work, but they're questioning what makes it worth it and do I want to do something different? And I think that's happening en masse to some extent. I mean, I will also say in the aggregate numbers, unemployment claims have been steadily decreasing as the economy is starting to sort of reopen. People are getting vaccinated. There was a great jobs report on Friday showing lots of people going back to work. So I think we all need to bide our time a little bit. But I do think there is going to be this effect of some people sort of questioning, is this work worth it? And it's up to employers to make it worth it. It is a marketplace. And if employees are saying, I'm worth more than that, and they feel they have the bargaining power to assert it, then employers are going to have to respond. That's the way a market works. I think that there is more power in workers' hands, and they are using it to with their feet, and them's the breaks. Like, as employers, then you need to figure out how to entice people to want to do the work that you have on offer.
Yeah, it's fascinating to see those stories coming out that a lot of employers are figuring that out and raising wages. I mean, I don't know how much it's happening, and I don't know where it's exactly happening, but I see a lot of those stories, which I feel like I didn't see before. Again, that's just my reading of the internet from my stupid shed. Well, my lovely shed. I love it here. I didn't mean
to lovely shed.
Meaning I'm like not going out and doing the hard work. Could I just ask you if what you think is going to actually pass through Congress? I am so confused, Bryce, and I'm not sure how closely you follow the politics these days of it all. You're really, you know, in depth in doing the policy of it, and I'm really confused with what's being debated and what's going to be passing with or without a filibuster, with reconciliation, in terms of these programs that you're writing about that are so vital to Americans. I keep hearing people talk about, we are going to cut child poverty in a third or in half, and I'm not sure if that funding has gone through, if we're waiting that funding. What's happening? What's going to happen? Do you mind that last question?
Sure. Well, so in terms of child poverty, the child tax credit has been enhanced for this year. So it has the power, if it reaches people, which is a huge open question, if people all know about it and can access it, to cut child poverty in half for the year. But it expires after that. So there's a fight on to try to extend it. And to be honest, I have no idea where that goes. I think it depends on where it gets tacked on and how persuasive Democrats can be amongst themselves. And then we've got the infrastructure deals. Basically, there's two different things on board right now. There's the bipartisan deal that's basically, like we said at the beginning, sort of the hard infrastructure of roads and bridges and waterways. The numbers have been whittled down by Republicans. Biden is claiming that he can still get the same amount done with less money. I don't know that I buy that, but that could pass on bipartisan lines. The other track is the Democratic reconciliation package that's supposed to sort of be everything else. They are saying that they're still going with it. I think what we don't know about that other package is what's in it. You know, Democrats would like to see all the money taken out of the hard infrastructure by Republicans put in that other package. And others are saying, no, we're not going to do that. And then how big is it? You know, is Joe Manchin going to keep this price tag so little that we can't really get good investments in things like childcare and home care?
Right.
Or are we going to be able to persuade him and other, you know, centrist Democrats that this is smart for the economy, and it's also smart for their political fortunes? This is stuff that Americans want. This is stuff that Americans often think that we've already done and are shocked to hear that
yeah.
we haven't.
Yeah, it's a good point.
Paid leave, everybody thinks we have paid leave. We don't have guaranteed paid leave. We could if it makes it into this package. So I don't know what the politics are there. That's like above my pay grade, but those are the two tracks. And I think Democrats would be really stupid to let this moment pass, because this is stuff that will reap dividends for the economy. And if they're able to do it in a smart way and tell the American people that they're the ones to thank,
that's a really important point.
They will reap the political dividends. But
yeah,
you know, it's up to them.
Yeah, you have to, if you build a bridge, you have to put up a sign like, we did this. It was us.
It's our bridge.
We built the bridge, just so you know.
I mean, they should be doing that with the child tax credit. I don't know that they really are. I got a letter in the mail saying, you know, you may qualify for this enhanced child tax credit. And nowhere on it did it say passed by Democrats, signed by Joe Biden. And I was like, come on, you've got to. Trump sent checks out with his name on them.
I was just about to say that. I was about to feel like, listen, Trump held up those checks for 2 days, by the way, because he's so horrific. Because people needed that money weeks ago. He held it up to 2 days. Wait, don't send it out to my signature. It's not like one of the smarter things he did. I mean, the only smart thing that guy ever did was put his name on everything. But like everything else he does, that ended up backfiring. Now people want his name off of everything. But like that's what we're talking about. Branding. That's what all he knows is branding. Not real estate, not politics, just branding. Just put my name on that. And now he's a toxic brand, which hopefully history will look back similar to other toxic brands. Some of which apparently we just found out he thought did some good things, some of those toxic brands.
Yes, I know what you're talking about. And, you know, it's just one of many amazing things that come out of his mouth. But, I mean, look how far he got on literally nothing but a brand. And I'm not saying the Democrats should follow that lead entirely, but it matters.
It matters.
That you tell people we're the ones to thank. We did this for you. We did something that materially improves your life. That's the way politics is supposed to work.
Yeah.
We go to DC, we do something that makes your life better. You keep voting for us, we'll keep doing it. Like, that's politics at its best.
Yeah, I've always thought why liberals and progressives and Democrats in power, I mean, don't try to change the table a lot more in terms of we're, if you like fiscal conservatism, we're the fiscal conservatives. Look at every Democratic president, look at Congress. We pay for things that we do. We're fiscally conservative. They fight wars and give out Medicare benefits and never pay for them. And they can't, like, that's a branding issue for Democrats. Nobody thinks Democrats are fiscal conservatives. They are. They're the more fiscally conservative party, I try to argue. You can make that case easily.
I also think voters just don't care about fiscal conservatism, not nearly as much as they care about the government doing things that make their lives better. I think that a lot of Americans are skeptical the government really can, and for good reason. The government has not proved itself to be doing much of anything lately.
Yep. Yep.
But if you can prove that you can do something materially important for someone, I think that that's what Americans want. They want help with their childcare crisis. They want good care for their elderly relatives.
I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right about that. And I think a really good place to look would be, like, right now in Texas, their Republican governor, when it got cold and the state shut down, and it got hot and the state shut down. And you have to wonder how even conservative Republicans, like, listen, you fucked up, dude. I don't care who you are. The lights keep going off. We need our lights on, our AC on, our heat on, our water to work. And you would think, hopefully, that would backfire. But a state like Texas, I don't know.
I most people are not talking about the intricacies of policy like you and I. They are trying to live their lives and get by. So when they see something like the lights aren't on, or I don't know where to put my kid in childcare, or I can't make the bills this month because my income is so volatile, and then something comes along and addresses that, that's what they care about. They don't care if it was passed through reconciliation. They don't care if it was bipartisan. They don't care if it was paid for. They just want to see those things addressed in their daily lives. And Democrats have the chance to do that right now.
It's a great, great point. Also in Texas, you have to wonder if they care more about the lights on or being able to carry a gun anywhere without a license. Like, which issue do you think? All right, that was unfair and unnecessary. I don't know. Bryce, it's so awesome talking to you. I really, I loved, you know, getting ready to talk to you and reading all your stuff. I always love following you on Twitter, and I hope we get to talk again. Thank you very much for joining me. I learned so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.